Hey there, I'm Professor Michael Wolff, and this is Gangs, Organized Crime, and the State in the Americas online. Welcome to the class.
Soy el fuego que arde tu piel, soy el agua que mata tu ser, el castillo, la torre, yo soy la espada que guarda el caudal, tú el aire que respiro yo, y la luz de la luna en el mar, la garganta que ansió.
Now first, I need to say something. My hope is that with this class, you walk away at the end of the quarter with a much deeper understanding of criminal violence and a much deeper appreciation for its complexity than you would get from simply watching every single Netflix series out there about Pablo Escobar and El Chapo Guzman. On the other hand, watching those series might give us a glimpse into a bigger part of the problem of criminal violence in the first place. That is, somewhere deep inside of us, I think we humans somehow think that violence and all that comes with it, the sex, the money, the flaunting of status symbols, it's all really cool. But let's leave that question to the philosophers. For now, I want to really begin this class with an important concept. And here it is, the social bandit, a term coined by the historian Eric Hobsbawm in his 1959 book, Primitive Rebels, Studies in Archaic Forms of Social Movement in the 19th and 20th Centuries. According to Hobsbawm, the social bandit is the byproduct of the encroachment of the modern state and its economic corollary, capitalism. Now, that puts the social bandit's origins somewhere during the last 250 years. However, social bandits have surely existed for as long as sophisticated political orders have. And here's why. Whenever you hear of the expansion and the consolidation of any kind of political order, whether it's a baby, or a kingdom, or an empire, or the modern state, what you are also really suggesting is that there has been a subjugation and perhaps the elimination of local political cultures and hierarchies, and the forced assimilation of these things into a new dominant political order. And as you might imagine, the imposition of this new order, what with all its strange new norms and laws, on top of the tribute one might be forced to pay, is often resisted by the masses, if you will. Now, the problem of resistance is that it's difficult and futile in most cases. First, the populations, mostly peasants in these cases, that are being forcibly inducted into a new political order have neither weapons to fight the encroaching state power, nor the education to help them articulate what exactly it is that they're fighting for. So instead of fighting, they tend to sort of invest their hopes, often in a vague and non-committal way, in those occasional figures who, for some unlucky happenstance, find themselves in conflict with the new authorities. They're on the run from the law, so to speak. Now, those figures, which are Hobsbawm's social bandits, then find themselves in a peculiar situation. By running from the law, they become folk heroes and to the local population who despise the new political order. And then to survive, they typically run out to the hills and the forest to hide, coming to town only to steal, usually from the rich or from anyone who was in cahoots with the new authorities, or to exact revenge on the new authorities for this or that injustice. Now, occasionally, they will distribute the spoils of their conquest among the poor, enhancing the Robin Hood image and giving all the more reason for the local population to protect them from the pursuit of the law, whether by providing them food or shelter, information about the whereabouts of state forces, or just refusing to cooperate with the new authorities in the first place. Now, eventually, at least according to Eric Hobsbawm's analysis, the social bandit loses this game of cat and mouse, because the state, being infinitely more powerful in both resources and organizational sophistication, successfully imposes its new political order on the local population. And to make an example of what should happen to anybody who continues to resist, the state usually sends the police force to hunt down the bandit, killing him good and dead, sometimes twice, sometimes three times, right? Or in the case of my favorite social bandit, the famous Brazilian cangaceiro, known as Lampião, the state killed him, figuratively speaking, hundreds of times. Why they paraded his decapitated head from town to town for several years after they finally laid him dead in an ambush in 1938. This is Lampion with his wife Maria Bonita, by the way. He got on the wrong side of the law back in 1921 after killing the man who killed his dad. Now, that wouldn't have been such a big problem had it happened a few decades earlier. Indeed, such honor killings would have been expected. But by the 1920s, the Brazilian state was rapidly expanding its bureaucratic control across the country's hinterlands. And according to this emerging political order, well, killing somebody was illegal and the state couldn't just let that slide. And so the new police went after Lampion, who successfully evaded capture for nearly 20 years. When he was finally betrayed by some locals who, seeing the future for what it was, threw in their cards with the modern state and threw their old friend under the bus, so to speak. Yeah, I had to get rid of that baby. Oh my God, babies. What? Of course, if Hobsbawm's analysis was all that mattered, our conversation about the social bandit would always be a conversation about the past. A conversation about how people resisted encroaching political orders before the time of the modern state, before the modern state successfully asserted its monopoly on the legitimate use of force, and before groups of people developed more sophisticated modalities of collective action, things like political parties or insurgent organizations in order to influence political outcomes. But Hobsbawm's analysis is not all that matters. The thing is, the social bandit is still very much alive and well, even in countries where the modern state seems to be the strongest, like in the United States today. When I was a little kid back in the 1990s, or teenager for example, I already had such a contemporary favorite social bandit, who was none other than the famous Tupac Shakur, the rapper son of a Black Panther, who by using his run-ins with the law as a platform to express criticism of an unjust social order, became a hero in the eyes of millions of people, someone who was fighting back against a system that seemed rigged to keep some people down and others in a permanent state of privilege.
Some say the blacker the better, the sweeter the juice. I say the darker the flesh and the deeper the roots. I give a holler to my sister's own welfare. Tupac cares if don't nobody else care. And I know they like to beat you down a lot. And when you come around the block, brothers clown a lot. But please don't cry, dry your eyes, never let up. Forgive but don't forget, girl, keep your head up.
Just like Hobsbawm's social bandit, Tupac's followers regarded him as their champion, idealized him, and turned him into a myth. But just like Hobsbawm's social bandit, Tupac was also little more than an endemic protest against oppression and poverty, a cry for vengeance on the rich and the oppressors, and a vague dream of some curb upon them, a righting of individual wrongs. In other words, his mother may have been a revolutionary, but Tupac himself was more of a social bandit, what Hobsbawm would call a primitive rebel, one whose rebelliousness mirrors the divisions and struggles within a society without really trying to reverse them. But why does the social bandit still emerge today? And can Hobsbawm's conceptual framework help us answer this question? Well, in part, I think yes, with a few caveats. You see, Hobsbawm saw social banditry as a uniquely rural phenomenon, a peasant protest against the encroachment of a new political order that threatens an old one. But if we take out the insistence on rural spaces, and we start looking at the geography of any place where conglomerates of human communities exist, well, we quickly find that the question of expanding and contracting political orders is never really settled. No matter how strong a state becomes, there are usually still cracks or fissures or what Frederick Thrasher calls interstices, we'll talk about this a little bit next week, that lie in the bedrock of national society. These are spaces where formal state authority doesn't really exercise a true monopoly of legitimacy. And when the state does try to exercise its authority in these spaces, it often bungles it up real bad, typically creating resistance where it wants to do away with it, and creating the perfect conditions for the emergence of none other than our social bandit. Let's take the Robert Taylor Holmes housing project on the south side of Chicago as an example. We'll read about this later in the quarter, I think in a couple weeks. Back in the late 1950s, when they were being built, the projects were supposed to provide decent housing for families of any race and varying income levels, but for a variety of reasons, they quickly became very poor, very black, and very abandoned by state authorities. When drug and gang violence became a serious problem over the following decades, the state did try to come back in, but only with the hard hand of the law in the form and the style of the war on drugs. No, the result? The local population began to see the state as a corrupt and abusive force, and so they threw in their cards with those who seemed to be fighting back against it. These were the gang leaders, the strongmen, the social bandits, if you will. We'll talk more about this in a couple weeks when you read Sudhir Venkatesh's book, Gang Leader for a Day. It's an excellent read. Excellent book. Believe me. The point is that the modern state rarely exercises a monopoly of legitimate authority evenly across its entire national population. And where it doesn't, its attempts to impose its own order is often met with the kind of resistance that has likely produced social banditry. This is especially true in countries marked by deep social inequalities, and particularly where those social inequalities are racially or ethnically structured. And that, my friends, brings us to Latin America, which from Mexico all the way down to the southern tip of Argentina represents the most unequal of all world regions. And I suspect that it's by no consequence that it is also the world region with the highest rates of murder, violent crime, and a majority of that which is driven by conflicts between rivaling gangs and other criminal groups. The subject of this class, of course. Indeed, Latin America and the Caribbean are home to 43 out of 50 of the most murderous cities in the world, and 8 of the 10 most murderous countries in the world. I'm currently in the most violent of all of those countries right now, in Brazil, at least in absolute terms. Brazil sees 60,000 murders each year. Averaged out, that's about 165 murders every single day, week after week, month after month, in just one country. The toll that this violence takes on a society can't easily be quantified. All across Latin America, you see how it shaped virtually everything over the last few decades. In many countries, private security guards now outnumber police officers because so few people trust the latter to protect them. In virtually every country, high walls trimmed with razor wire or shards of glass now surround the homes of city dwellers. And in some places, like Guatemala City, millions of people hole up in their homes when night falls, fearing the whims of roaming criminal bands. And of course, there is the personal toll violence takes on families and communities. As some of you may already know firsthand, when somebody close to you dies, they don't just disappear, you know. They often leave a huge gaping hole in the structure of one's family, of one's community. And when they die violently, well, this hole is all the wider, all the deeper, and the despair all the greater. All this is to say that the study of gangs, organized crime, and the state in the Americas isn't just a matter of curiosity or entertainment. It's a sort of quest to find ways to fix a problem that is so clearly broken, or at least to minimize the damage it creates in any way possible. It really is a question of life and death, after all. So, where do we begin? Well, of course, with our beloved social bandit. If we can figure out why he keeps popping up, why he behaves the way he does, and why we love him so much, well, maybe this will give us at least some clues to help us get started. On that note, it's time for you to jump into your first assignment. I want you to read Primitive Rebels right away, which is available on our Canvas webpage. Then get working on your first video project. A little introduction, about 1 to 2 minutes about yourself, and include a little story about your own favorite social bandit. I'm sure you have one. I think we all do. It's in our blood. In the meantime, I'm looking forward to meeting you. I'm Professor Michael Wolf, and this is Gangs, Organized Crime, and the State in the Americas Online.
Soy el fuego que arde tu piel. Soy el agua que mata tu ser. El castillo, la torre, yo soy. La espada que guarda el caudal. Tú el aire que respiro yo. Y la luz de la luna en el mar. La garganta que ansía.